Hello everyone, welcome to a new Flahome livestream. It's been a few weeks, but I'm back. So let's see. Is it laggy? I think it's okay. We'll go with it. Okay, so two people watching, maybe. I never know if it's myself when I do a preview. No, but it says two people watching, one like. Okay, so let's get started. What we will do today. So, let's switch to the forum. So, we will make an extension to create new pages on Flahome. So, maybe you remember, I have not checked how long ago it was. So, during a previous stream, I made this. It must be already 2-3 months ago. So I made an about page. Maybe it's still available actually. Let's see. It was when we were still on beta 15. So maybe it's still working. Did I add the link? Yes, okay. So that was the page. So that's what we did in a previous live stream. We added an about link, and the about link was just rendering a page with some text. And how it worked was, so we had a JavaScript module. Here we just registered one root and one link in the navigation. And then the page was handled by a component. That component was setting a page title and rendering the body of the page with a title and a content. And the content was coming from a translation. So the text was inside of here, and it was actually translated, so the page was also in French. And on the backend, we had a root being registered with the frontend extender. So that was the line that added the slash about page. And then there was also a content class, and that content class was setting the body of the page, the HTML body, to the same content. So that way, when you browse the page without JavaScript, actually I can also disable JavaScript from here. I think so. Never remember where it is. It's not this one. So how did we disable JavaScript again? Oh, I have forgotten where the settings are. Is it here? Oh, okay, it's here. Settings, disable JavaScript. And we can see we still see the page because it was set as the NoScript. Not here actually, but here. It was set as the NoScript of the page as well. So basically we want to do something similar to that, but the source of the data will be some files in a folder. So, yeah. And if you have any question about what I'm doing or about something else with Flahome extensions, just let me know in the chat. I have the chat visible on my other screen. And yeah, we will go ahead with the extension. So what we will do first, I will show you how it will look for the source data. So I have my new forum here, which is Flahome 1.0. I will create a folder. It can be anywhere. I will actually just create it at the root of Flahome itself. I will just call this pages. And here we will create two pages. So one of the pages will be called contact.html. Now let's do one called contact.md. This one will be just called contact. And the ID here is something we will do later. We will have a form. let's just do it like this for now. Let's imagine that it's just Markdown. Maybe we will add a link so that we know that it's Markdown. Contact us via email. And here we will, let's put an email. Let's do it like this, email, mail to let's just put my email. Contact us via email or use the form below. Let's put that as a content. Okay, next we will do another one. It will be called Terms of Use. So you can see how I'm planning to do this. I'm planning to have a form matter prefix at the top of the file. So this is some content with some YAML in between, or at least some pseudo YAML. I'm not sure if we will load a YAML parser for that or not. But basically, we'll just today we do mostly a proof of concept. But yeah, so terms of use, and here we will actually do some lorem ipsum. Don't remember if I can choose how much. It's not even a lot. Let's put 30 paragraphs of lorem ipsum. Okay. And we will use that as the page body. Maybe we can add some titles. Let's put article 1. Article 2, article 3. Okay, let's do it like this. Let's do it like this. And next, we can do another page, this time HTML. So let's call this one findus.html. Oh yeah, it's a so we still have the font matter, but yeah. So let's call this one find us, and we will use an embed here. We will use, let's use Google Maps, or maybe we can just put a YouTube video. I don't know what will appear if I put, a Google embed. Now let's put Google Maps because that's what I'm planning to do. Let's me just do that on my other screen. I will pick something at random. Let's just put what do I have here? I have some things. Okay, let's use just that. Embed, integrate, copy HTML. Okay. Okay, so I have copied some embed HTML from Google Maps. We will see later. And here I can add a paragraph. It's very simple to find us. Okay. So, yeah. And another thing I want to implement, I'm not sure if I do it now, we will do it later probably. So, we have three pages, two are made of Markdown, one is made of HTML, and basically I want to automatically create a URL /contact/find-us/terms-of-use on Flarom, and it will automatically render those pages with the content of those files. That's the basics for what we are going to implement. And hi Daniel, glad you could join. yeah, let's do this. So we will need a new extension. Actually, something about this, we will not make an actual extension. So this will be how to say that, because there will be no UI to edit those pages. So it's not an extension you can just install and start creating pages from the web browser. You will actually need to create a folder somewhere, and then you will use the Flahom extender to tell Flahom where the pages can be found. That's how I want to do it. So basically, we will create an extension, but it will not have the type Flahom extension. It will be similar to my... I don't know if you have seen the local extender. Well, of course, Daniel has seen the local extender's extension, but basically, this one is also not a real Flahom extension. It's a set of extenders. So basically, we'll create something similar where you install the package, which is not a Flahom extension, and then you call an extender. So that's how it will work. So let's go to the Workbench folder and copy an extension as a starting point. I think I will just copy author change. Let's create a new extension like this. So there is the extension generator that you can use as well to start new extensions. I have not checked if it can do TypeScript yet. I just like to copy my old extensions. So I was not sure how to call this one. I was thinking static pages, but actually it's not really static pages, because when we talk about static pages, we have static pages generators. Because if you, like the syntax I use, you will notice if you are familiar with static website generators like Jekyll, it's how they work as well. But it's not static pages, it's a static pages generator. And in this case, it does not generate into static pages, it generates into not exactly dynamic pages inside the Flahom. So I think I will just call this pages generator instead, because the word static does not really make sense in Flahom, because it does not generate HTML files as the output. So I will just call it Flahom pages generator, I think. Sorry. So yeah. Let's go inside of the folder. Let's delete the git and id folders, which are from the other extension. Next, I can also delete node modules. I can delete the log file. And I can also delete this log file and the vendor. Okay, now let's open this inside of here. So we had the static pages from before. Let's find Flahom 1.0 workbench. And where is it? Flahom pages generator. It's here. So let's open in PHP Store. Let's just wait for this. I'm just checking that everything is still working. I think you still have sound and everything. And you will soon not see me anymore because of the sun. we'll see if I need to light up some lights or not. So let's just edit the README. For now, it will just say Flahom pages generator. This next the license file. I can just drop the date. Let's focus on composer.json. So this one will be just called Flahom pages generator. Generate pseudo static pages for Flahom from markdown and HTML files. Okay, let's do it like this. Pages, and let's just stay like this. So we don't need the replace stuff. We don't have a URL for now. We don't actually need this because it won't be a FlaHome extension. Let's maybe check what I put in the local extenders. Did I put a type? No, I didn't even put a type. So it will default to project, I think, or package. I'm not sure. But yeah, and we don't really need. I mean, I can add the support links later. We don't need that either. So yeah, the namespace will be pages generator. Don't need really to keep the FlaHome prefix. Yeah. So Clark pages generator. Okay, and next I can just install this locally. So I have autocomplete. Okay. Next, I can update the namespace. No, I have nothing to update here because there is no extend.php because it's not an extension. Likewise, here, no extend.php because everything will be exposed as an extender that you need to call yourself. So, yeah. Next. So those were all things that were there before. I will just delete and create a new SRC folder. Okay. So we had some translations. I'm not sure we will need translations, but we might need some CSS. And we will definitely have some JavaScript because this will not be able to work without JavaScript. Okay, so I'm not exactly sure how I want to call it, but let's just call it pages for now, I guess. So actually, there will be no, there will probably not be a single PHP file, but one file will be an extender. So pages ex not extends implements extender interface from FlaHome, and inside of here we can do some stuff. And what we will have is the pages extender will have a function called source. Here we will have a path. And then we will store that somewhere. Public, no, protected path will be an array. And next we can just add path equal path. And we will return this path. So, that's not something you will do often to create extenders unless you make an extension that is designed to be reused by other extensions. But basically, we just need to meet the extender interface and then we can do anything we want. But kind of the convention is to have methods on an extender that just return itself and change something so that you can so that you can chain the method calls. So yeah, so I guess you will see soon. So we have pages, you can add sources, and something will happen in extend. And now I can already call this code. So what I will do, I will open my local extend.php. Okay, so there is nothing. Yeah, there is nothing here. So I will register an extender here. So I will actually call this extender. So I will do new call this pages. Actually, I need to do it like this. And next, I can just call source And here we will have the source. So it will be a link to the current directory / pages. And that's all we need. This will actually return the extender instance in the array. And then Flarom will take care of it because it will actually run this method. And it will pass the container and the extension. And I have a bug, you can see. Sometimes I have some text. I don't know if you can actually see it in the live stream. Oh, now it's gone. Okay, I'm not sure if you see the title, the little title that pops up. Sometimes it stays visible. I think it's from here. If I change, yeah, you can. I don't know if you can see it. Let me just check. Yes, I think you can see it. The little pop-up from Firefox. If I switch Windows with Alt Tab, then it sometimes it doesn't disappear. But that's not really important. Yeah. So what we can do here is just maybe we can do a var dump of this path and die. And just check if that works. So I will install my package in Flarom. So I can actually go back to the Flarom folder, do composer require my package. And I can install the @dev version. That works the same way as extensions. When you do development, if it's a package, if it's a normal packagist package or just or an extension, it still works the same to install it. You can see now it's installed. The difference is that, of course, it will not appear in the Flarom admin. But we see what I have just done. Yeah, but if I remove my call in extend.php, I can access the admin, but you will not find the extension here. Because yeah, it's not an extension. But when I call this from the local extend.php, you can see that I have the path to my folder. Okay, great. So now let's extract all the files that are in that folder. So we can do this in multiple ways. I know there is a way in PHP to natively loop over the content of the files, but I was wondering if we have access to the file system in Laravel, because I don't remember. So we don't have access to facades, but I can actually use I should be able to use these functions. I'm not actually sure if we have them in Flarom, because I know that the all files, I think it's this one. It's one of these two functions, I think. It has the benefit of returning all the files, including inside of subdirectories. Maybe let's just make a quick search. So PHP list files recursively. Oh, maybe you can just use this. No, I don't think it will return. Oh, it works. I mean, I really like the API from Laravel, but now I'm just not exactly sure how to access it from Flarom, because in Flarom there is a container binding, but I don't think that container binding exists in Flarom. So yeah. It does exist, it's here. So files, new file system. Where is it defined? So we can see there is a binding called files. So it might be compatible with the Laravel file system. I suspect it is an instance of the Laravel file system. Question is, where is it defined? It must be in a service provider somewhere. So there are multiple pages of results. Okay, file system service provider, that sounds good. Files in an is an instance of file system. Okay, so that's great. So what it means is that we can access the files with that. So let's go back to here. So we can do files equals container make files. And files will be an instance of the file system. Where is it? New file system, and it's from illuminate file system. So file system, and we can even use a contract. So yeah, so files is an instance of the Laravel file system, and we can do this because Flarom already registered this in the container. So then it means we can use files, and here we should be able to do the all files, and here we can just use path. So what we need to do is for each around the path as a path, and then the path we will use it to list all files in that path, and we will put that let's just call it names for now, and let's do a dump of this. Let's see what happens. So something happens, but it's not very readable. It's more readable like this. So we can see there are three objects, and we have instances of SPL file info. So that sounds great, but I don't actually know if it works because I have not created a subfolder. So let's maybe do a folder called about, and put contact inside of about. Let's do it like this. Now let's see if it still works. Okay, so it still works. That's what I wanted. So I don't need to make multiple calls myself to get the content of every directory. Laravel has that implemented already. I'm not sure what the difference was with just files. Okay, so that's the difference. Just files return everything that's inside of the directory, but all files recursively fetches everything. And if I go inside of, I can actually check the implementation. No, it's just a boolean on files. Then it's list content. Oh wow, there's a lot of stuff. Yeah, we don't need to worry about how it's implemented. It works, so that's fine. Okay. So now we have the name of each file. So next we need to decide how it's called, how the URL is called. We will build the URL based on the path. And we can actually use the relative path, I think. So how can I do this? Is it type hinted? Don't know if it's type hinted. It's not type hinted. So we need to type hint just so that it works. So this is SPL file info. So let's import this. Names is an array of SPL file info. Then we will do for each of the names as file, and then I can just try to dump again just to check how it looks, and I can do file, can I get relative path? Is it this one? let's just try to dump this. So I have about, empty string, and empty string. So that's not what I need. Is it path name? Okay, so that's more interesting. So that's what I probably need. I will build my URL based on this, and I will just remove the extension. So can I actually get the file extension from this? Extension. Oh, I can get the file name without extension, and I can get the relative path. Let's see, can I build the URL with those two variables? So, about, contact, empty, find us. Okay, so I will need to add the slash. But apart from that, no, I think it's fine because I always need to add a slash. Let's just see. So I can do path. maybe let's call this folder. Call this one file name. And yeah, the path. Yeah, I already have that variable. So let's do URL equals folder and file name. And here we will add another check. So if there is a folder, then we will do folder, we will do slash. And folder. Otherwise, just an empty string. Okay, let's do it like this. And now, if I just do var dump my URL, now I have my three URLs. Perfect. And now we want to register those as Flarom roots. So, how are we going to do this? We will actually use the root, the frontend root extender. And I don't know how official this is, but I have been using it in some of my extensions. Basically, I want to call other Flarom extenders from my extender. That's not officially possible, but it's actually perfectly possible because since all extenders use the same extend format, we can just create native Flarom extenders and call them with the same parameters. So yeah, that's all we really need. So what we will do here is actually create an extender. So I can call this one front end, and it will be an instance of the front end extender for the forum. And here what I can do is call frontend root. For the path, I can use my URL. For the name, it will be pages generator. So I need a unique name. So I will just use the URL as unique name for now. Maybe I will do better later, but that's fine. Yeah, and actually, that's all I need there. And next, I will call frontend, and I will call myself the extend function of the extender, but call it with the parameter that I received here. And there we are. So there should be no error. So I'm still watching the source code. Okay. And now what we can do is check. So if I go to a page that doesn't exist, I get the 404 page. And I get a special page. I actually get I get the debug screen because I'm in debug mode. Otherwise, you will just see the... I don't remember what is written on the page, but there is a very simple page with nothing. But now let's check if one of our pages exists. So we had, how were they called? So let's try the terms of use. So if it works, it means we should not see a 404 page. Terms of use. And we don't see a 404 page. But you can also see that the URL has disappeared. So that's because when we use the frontend extender, like we do here, the page will automatically be handled by the Flahome single page app. And then the single page app will actually react. It will look in the single page app router if the page exists. And if it does not exist there, it will actually redirect to the home page. So the next step will be to register the page in the forum frontend, like in the single page app router. Oh, there are lots of words to remember when we deal with this stuff. But it puts us in a situation here. We need this list to be available in the frontend. Right now, it's just computed inside of an extender. But how are we going to expose this to the frontend? So, actually, there is a way. At some point, I will need to cache all of this to improve performance. But I might not need to do it right now. So, actually, I already have a list. What I could do... So, I already have my list of URLs here. So, I could just put them in an array. So, I can do it like this. And somehow show this somewhere in the forum frontend. And actually I can do that because I can use the another extender. I can use the serializer extender. Is it called serializer extend? No, it's called API serializer. So I can call this extender. I can call it on the forum serializer, and I can add, I can use the attributes function, register a callback. I can actually use the URLs array that I already have in this context, and then I can return. I could use attribute singular, just have this called generator pages, maybe. Let's just call it like this. And then I can just return the URLs. Like this. And I need to do one more thing here. If I do just this, nothing will happen because I'm just creating an extender and saving it nowhere. But again, I just need to call the extend function, and that way I can make this into a kind of child extender. So it will always execute with the parent extender. Let's see if anything changes. So obviously this will not fix the issue in itself. But what I can check is if the value is there. So I can log app.forum.attributes. Is it data.attributes? Okay. And I can check what's inside of the forum attributes. And here, if it works, I think I see it here. Generator pages. And you can see I have an array with my pages. So now I just need to tell Flahome that those pages exist in the front end. So, how are we going to do this? We will need some JavaScript. So here we have a few things in the JavaScript that I copied. we will actually not have anything in the admin because our extension doesn't have settings because it's not an extension. So we will actually only have some forum stuff. So I can also delete the admin from here. So we will have some components, but we won't reuse these ones. And here we will also not need too much. So yeah, let's just delete all of this. So yeah, next step. So we will need to name this initializer. So let's call this pages generator. And to register routes, we need to use app.routes. And we just need to add a new key. And I never remember exactly. I think it's pass something. And then we will have component something. I think I can drop all of this stuff. I will keep extend for now. We might need it later. So basically, we need to give the routes a name and a path. And oh, we can do that because it's actually inside of the forum. I think there is just one problem, is that we don't have access to app.forum at this point. Let's just log this, comment this out. Let's rename the package to, let's just name it pages generator. What the hell is that? Why do we have a beta of tsconfig? We still have not tagged the tsconfig. No, we do have a tagged. Don't know why it's not using the tagged. Let's use this then. Yeah, I'm just changing the name before installing the dependencies. I don't think it changes much, but yeah, might as well do it now. So next I can go in that folder if I find it somewhere. I will open a new window, I guess. Workbench generator is somewhere here, JavaScript. I can do yarn install. And yeah, I didn't say hello. I see a few messages. I guess it's all about hands that are raised. I don't know what the last emoji is from Harry. I guess it's just people saying hello to each other. Is that a YouTube? Is that a YouTube emoji? Don't know that one. Then I run yarn dev to watch the files, and now I have my files. But how are we going to include the JavaScript since we don't have an extension? So again, we will use a child extender. So actually, we already have a front-end extender. So I can just add it here. I can just call CSS, not CSS, JavaScript. And then, so I need to actually go up here a folder, then JavaScript, dist, forum. Like this. And while I'm doing this, I might as well just add the CSS. So for now, the file is empty, but we know it exists. So I will go to resources, less, and include forum.less. So that's already done. Let's go back to the forum, see if anything changes. So if my JavaScript is loaded, we can see there is a console.log. It was not there previously, so I'm pretty sure it's my console log. I can even go here, check. Okay, you can see when I log app.forum, unfortunately, it's not available yet. That's, I mean, we might change that in Flarom at some point, but right now the way it works, because extensions can use initializer to register new attributes on the forum model, then you cannot access the forum model yet because we need to register the attributes before we can access any attribute. And so we end up in a chicken and egg situation, because here the routes are supposed to be defined before the forum is loaded, but we need the attributes that are in the forum to make the routes. But luckily, we don't actually really need the forum model, we just need to access the values. And the values, they are always there at page load. So we can actually do app.data. And inside app.data, we have everything that's loaded with the page. And I think it's here. So the information is somewhere here. Because it's inside of the resources, then there is the forum and the attributes are here. But what we can do is actually add the attributes directly to the app.data, which actually makes more sense. But I'm not sure if we can do it as simply as here, because here we can just use a variable and return it here. I think we can actually do it, because what I can do here is add how do I do this? So I can add a content callback that will add information to every page. And actually, as long as the URL exists, I can pass it here. So I can use, can do use URLs, and then inside of here, I think I get access to, so the callback receives a document instance from Flarom. So Flarom frontend document, okay. And here I can do document payload. And in payload, I can add an attribute named like this, and I can put my URLs. So let's see if it achieves what I want. So if I refresh the page and check inside of app.data, you can see that there is an array called generator pages. So that's the way I want it, but it's empty. So I'm not sure why it's empty. I mean, no, I'm pretty sure I know what it, why it's empty. But yeah, that's interesting, because this has to do with value versus reference. Here it works because actually when you use the keyword use, it will pass a value, it will pass a variable by value. So it means that here it takes what is inside URLs and pass it down, but it's not the same URL object. But here we use the object before we put anything in the array, so it's empty. So we have two options. Either we do this at the end, or we just use the ampersand to pass the array by reference. And we also no longer need this stuff, because now the value will be passed here. Let's refresh. So the app.forum is still null, but what we care about is the data inside app.data? And it is. We can see we have the array here. So now what we can do, if we go back to the JavaScript, we can actually not use app.forum, but app.data. And we can use this. So we can do this dot for each, and then we can do a loop, and inside of the loop we will register some routes, and for the name of the route we will just use the path for now, and for the path we will use the path. And if you don't know that syntax, if you do path column path, you can actually shorten it to just path when you are inside of an object definition. So that's the same. And we will need a component. So let's create the component. TypeScript, let's create a page. And what do we need for the page? Actually, I will go and copy what I had from the previous stream. So, oh no, I didn't open correctly. Okay, so that's the file I showed you at the start of the stream. So I will just copy this and use it as the base for my page. And we need to update a few things. It's flahome/forum/app and flahome/common/components/page. Don't need the global mid-trill stuff because we have global type definitions with TypeScript. So the page will just be called page, but we have a conflict. Let's call this one base page so that we don't have a conflict. Next we have, so here we will need to set the title, but we don't have the title yet. We need to see later how we will work with titles. So for now, let's just import vnode from mid-trill. So this is just because of TypeScript. If you don't use TypeScript, you don't need to add type hints, but I will just add the types like this. So yeah, for now I will keep these translations. No, maybe I will just put some random text. To do title here. Let's do it like this. And I will do the same here, so the title will also be title here. And here we will have to do content here. Okay, next. Let's refresh. Okay, so there is an error. Page is not defined. Let's go back to here. That's because I have not imported the page. So like this. Let's refresh. Okay, so now let's see if it works. So we had terms of use and we can see it works. So the page is rendered and I see my dummy content from the page. So yes, perfect. Next, we need to load the content of that page. So here we have a few options as well. So we could actually change, so if I show back my app.data, I can actually do generate. So what I could do here in that array, I could actually, instead of just listing the URLs, I could list objects, and each object I could put the path, the title, the content, and that would work. And that would actually probably be perfectly fine for a lot of forums. But the problem is that the more pages you have, the more content you will have in that array. And everything will be loaded with the page. And I don't actually want to do it that way because I'm planning to use this on a website where there will be a lot of pages. Like 20 plus pages, and each page will additionally be translated in multiple languages. So that's not realistic. For performance, it wouldn't be good. But even for just, yeah, the way it works, I don't want to bloat, to fill up the content here of the object of the app.data unnecessarily. And yeah. So basically, we want to load pages only when we visit them. So that's where we start to get very different from what we did in the other live stream with, oh, I have closed it. So it's a very simple static page. It was different because in the other static page, we used translations, and translations are bundled inside of Flahome. By the way, if you ever wondered where the text are, you can see there are two files. One is called forum.js and the other one is called forum-english.js. And actually inside the English file, you just have a big JSON object with just all of the translations. So of course, the more extensions you have and the more translations you have, this file will also fill up. And at least there is one per language, but still. It's not ideal. So we will load each page separately. But how do we load the pages? So So we will actually use the REST API. We will create a new endpoint in the REST API, and we will be able to ask that endpoint for a page. So yeah, let's do this. So we will create a new folder here. Let's call this controller. Maybe let's follow the Flarom syntax. So let's call this API, and inside of API, there will be a single controller and single serializer. So let's just put everything at the root. So we will have show page controller, and next we will have page serializer. So the show page controller will extend the abstract show controller from Flarom. We need to implement a data method, and here we will have some stuff. So the serializer will be page serializer, and inside of the data method we will return something, and I will show you shortly what it will be. So I'm not sure if I prefer to use query strings or path for the request. I think we'll use query strings because it will be easier. So here basically what I want to do, so I will have a page serializer, and the serializer needs to extend abstract serializer from Flarom, and a serializer needs a function. Does add method steps? Okay, that's it. So we need get default attributes, and here we will return some attributes. And we need a type. So the type will be generator page. Just call it like this for now. So if you have worked with serializers before, you will probably know that we use a Laravel eloquent model with a serializer. So because usually a serializer is to serialize something from the database. But in our case, it's not from the database. And you can see there is no type hint on the model to be an eloquent model. Actually, if you take a look at the source code of the serializer stuff in Laravel, and in Laravel uses a package by the original founder, Toby. So I don't know if there are any reference here. Yeah. So the serializer is something from the Topscure JSON API package. And basically you can check the documentation for that package. Actually, nothing is tied to the database. So we can actually have model can be anything. You can see here it's type hinted as object or array. So in our case, the pages will be defined by arrays, and we will return the array here. So actually for now, I will directly return the model itself as the values. I will do a bit better later, I think. But because the model will be an array, I can just return it like this. And what I can do here in the page controller is return what I will use. I will have something like title, hello. And next I will have content, hello world. So I will have something like this. And next I can register this controller. So again, we don't have an extend.php. So we will call this from inside our main extend. So here we will use the root extender. We will extend API, and here we will do a new get root, which will just be called slash generated route, and it will be answered by the show page controller. And next we call extend with the container and the extension. And there is one parameter missing here. We need to name this. It will be just called generated route. Okay, so now on the forum, nothing should have changed for now. So if I go to slash API slash generated route, you can see we have an error. We have an error because we need to return an ID property because the serializer expects this to have an ID property. So for now, let's just have ID be 0. And nothing has changed. Actually, yeah, maybe I need to use a different syntax if it's an array. So here I can define how the ID is retrieved. And if I go to the parent, yes, it's retrieved as an object. So because model will be an array, this will fail. So we have to redefine how the ID is obtained. For now, I will just return 0. I will hard code 0 as the ID. I need to catch up with the comments. Yeah, you can match. Yeah, I mean the ORM. I think ORM is usually used to define what Eloquent is. No, it's object relationship management. Yeah, no, yeah, okay. So that might be named as well. But yes, the serializers can be anything, and actually, one case of that is the forum. Forum serializer, there is no object name, there is no entity named forum in the database. So when you have the forum object that you can add attributes to using the forum serializer, it's just a serializer based on an array. And then attributes are added to that serializer. But forum is an abstract concept. There is a model for forum, but there is always one. And it's not a real entity in the database. So you can see when I hit my generated route, I get my payload. But now we need to tell this page which content we want, because I don't want to get always this text. I want to get the text of a given page. We need to start separating some stuff, because I need to access my list of routes, but now I'm outside of my extender. So I need a way to access my list of routes. And yeah, for that, we will actually create a new class. We will call that the page. Let's call it the page repository. And this class will handle the logic. So, how can I do this? So I will have a few methods. What's best here? So maybe I can have a function named loadPath, and then I can have a function named public. Maybe something named all, and maybe something named get. Maybe something like this. And should I use a new object for my pages? It's probably best if I use a new object. I'm starting to have a lot of stuff named similarly. I'm not sure how I will handle that, but for now I will just keep the things the same. So I will create an object just to represent my pages. So it will have, so here we will have an ID. So I will have an attribute named ID, an attribute named title, an attribute named content, and an attribute named URL. So, or maybe let's name it path. And maybe let's also have one named, no, I will add that later. So I have my class for describing a page. So next I will actually here copy my code. So the code that uses the file system will be here. So let's resolve the file system. I'm not actually sure if this binding exists in FlaRom. Maybe I need to check. So here we had the file system. I think I might have a problem because it's not type hinted. I have a singleton called files, but I don't think the file system itself is bound to the container. Let's check this. So here I use it, but does FlaRom use it? I don't see it being used in any constructor. And here maybe... no, it's using the file system factory. Yeah, so never mind. Okay, so I will just resolve it manually. I think it will be safer. So I will just copy all of this code here. And I will also copy this. Okay, but we don't have access to the container here, so we will actually have to use the global resolve function, which I tried to avoid it, but since there is no container binding, I cannot easily resolve from the constructor. So yeah, I just have a function that will access the file system. Next, we don't actually need this because it's no longer, here we just have one. So load path, it will go through all the files. And next here, what we'll have is an array of pages. And here we will have, how do I do this one? So we will have an array of pages. We will create a page, new page. Next we'll do page ID equals URL, page path equals URL. And for now we will have to stop there because we have not implemented the next steps. But here we will do this pages equals, we will add the page like this. Okay. And next here we can return all the pages, and to be able to get only the page we want, I think what we will do is prefix the pages by URL. Here we will just return the values without the key, and here we will return array get this pages, and we'll get the URL out of there. And that way it will return a page or null. And this will return an array of pages. Page and an array. So that's kind of the global ID. So here you can see the pages will be stored in this class. But now what we will do with this class, we will actually register it as a singleton so that it becomes a global class. So for that, we will create a new thing. We will create a service provider. The service provider will extend the abstract service provider from Flarom. Here we'll use the register function, and inside of here we'll do this container singleton page repository. And by doing it like this, now every time we use the page repository, it will be the same instance of the class. So now it means that inside of here, I can actually refactor this to resolve. Ah, can I do it like this? No, no, I cannot. No, I need to resolve it here. So I will use container make page repository, call this pages. Okay. Next, I will keep my loop here, but I will just do pages load path path. Okay, and this will load all of my stuff. And then I can do a completely different part of the code here. This I no longer need because it's moved to the other class. And here, don't even really need this. I can just use the pages. And here I will do array map. And I will map pages all, and I will use my function here to take a page, and I will return page URL. So, but it's not URL, it's path. Okay. So yeah, I think that will be good enough for this. Yep. Yeah, I don't actually know if I want to use a serializer, because here I will not use a serializer either, I think. Nah, it's better if I use a serializer. Okay, let's keep it like this. So here you can see now, instead of building the URL array, I still build a URL array, but I build it by using the map function on the list of all pages. And yeah, if I did everything correctly, it still works exactly the same as before. But we have still not added anything for this to work. So let's just check that this still works. So it no longer works. So that's not good. Let's check what this says. So var dump. Die. So seems like the code does not execute. Okay, so here we have things. So did I nuke the code? What? The content stuff seemed to no longer execute. That's because I did delete something. I deleted the code that registered the routes. So I still need that bit of code. So so here I still need the for each page, and then do yeah, I deleted the code. I should have kept just the bit that said the front-end route. And like this page. So which order is it? It's path. And then we have ID. And then here we have generated route dot like this. So why is it not type hinting? Oh no, it is. Okay. So maybe this will work better. Okay, so it's still the same as before. And yeah, it must be working because otherwise this page will not render. So yeah, we still have the array of paths and everything else is still okay. Perfect. So now we need to do something in show here to get the information about the page. So the way we will do it is to get the path from a parameter. So in the request, we will use query params. And here we will do rget query params. And we will take a parameter called path. And next, here we will retrieve the page. So page will be pages and get the path. So how are we going to get this working? We need access to pages, and to get pages, here we can use a constructor parameter. Maybe let's keep this one on top. So pages repository. Let's just call this one pages. This pages equals pages, and we can put that on a protected attribute. Okay, so now we have access to the page, and now what we can do here is, yeah, if there is no page, we will throw a new exception. I'm actually not sure. I know we can throw a model not found exception and Flarom will return a 404 page. I'm not actually sure if there is a better if there is a better way, because this error, this exception is supposed to be thrown for database errors. I'm not sure if Flarom has another built-in function for that or not. So error service provider. No, that's the only class that Flarom has built-in for 404 errors. So we can bind other errors. For now, we will just keep using that one. Okay, and next we return page, and it means that actually now the serializer is getting a page. So here we no longer need this workaround, and here we can actually type hint it because we know it will be an instance of page, which is not a Laravel model, it's just our simple class. But that way, if I do it like this, ne now I can do a proper serializer and I can do URL. Don't actually really need the URL, I think. Let's just call it path, and then we can have title and content like this. And here it's not happy. I don't remember having that error. Yeah, so I will just type into it here. So page is a page. Like this. Okay. So now let's see what happens if I go back to my API. So now, now I have an error argument passed to page repository get must be of type string null given. So, yeah, I know what it is. So here I do get and I take the pass. But if the parameter is not being sent, then this will return null. So I will actually just cast this to string. I mean cast or default to string. Cast is better because it will also handle if a user somehow passes an array. But yeah, okay, so now we get model not found exception. Okay, and now if I add pass equals something, still the same error. But if I use something that exists, no, it's still not working. So pass terms of use, was it called like this? Terms of use, yes. Okay, let's dump the pass to check if it works. Var dump pass. Okay, so that works. So until here, everything is good. Next, we get the page here. Array get. So I want to rename this one pass actually. But this page is. Is everything prefixed by URL? Var dump these pages. As you can see, my favorite method of debugging is just to add some var dumps. Okay, so here we see a problem. Actually, the problem is that there is nothing. There is no pages inside of here. So there must be a problem with the singleton. And of course, the problem is that I put the code here, but that code never runs. So, yeah. I'm not actually sure I need to use a. Don't really need to use a service provider for that. I can just run the code in my extender. Because otherwise, all I will do is register the service provider from the extender. And the register function of the service provider runs about at the same time as the extenders. So there is really not much difference. So I can just do the singleton here. Register the singleton before starting to use it, because otherwise it will not be registered as a singleton. But yeah. Okay, so now it's working. Okay, so this page exists, so it returns some information, but if the page doesn't exist, I get a 404 error. Perfect. But now we need access to the title and content. So we need to parse the files. Until now, we have not parsed the files. We will add the logic here. Here we need to set page title and page content. But how are we going to do this? I have not actually checked back if there is a good library for that. I know there are libraries for font matter. Let's just do a quick check. So that's what I would usually do. PHP font matter parser. And I have probably. Isn't. Oh, I thought. I wonder if there were some autocomplete from things I have seen before. So there are very likely libraries that do this. So the question is, do we want to use. Do we want to use a library or do we want to implement it ourselves? The benefit of using a library is that it will likely be more extensive and has maybe already tests. So the most featured font matter. Oh, there is also some alternate formats for font matter, I think, not only YAML. So I usually look at the number of stars and downloads, so this one is not very popular. I mean, a lot of libraries look very professional nowadays because people make good readmes and everything, but when I see such a little number of stars, I don't really like it because yeah, it might be good, but it's hard to know what exactly awaits us in the future. So, yeah, I think I have studied some of these previously, but I never used any. So let's check out another. So this one has 25 stars and has a non-advisable composer requirement. It's not a good idea to use bigger or equal to, because then if they make a major update, you will jump to the major update without noticing it. So that's why there is the caret version. So you can see most libraries, they have a simple system where you pass content and then they give you config and content. So yeah, I guess not very popular either. But this one is more interesting because it's made by Spacy. And even though there are not that many stars, it's Spacy. So it's not the developers are quite well known. So what do they support? Parse, matter, body, title. I think that looks like the best option for now. Very simple API, known developers. Not a recent release, however, but that shouldn't be a big issue because, yeah, it's quite a simple library. I see they have unit tests, so I guess that's good. That's a good choice. Yeah, I think let's go with that unless there is something else. Oh, PHP League has So the pages are not Eloquent is not used in this extension. Everything is stored with files. I showed at the beginning how the files look. I will show them again shortly. I just wanted to check some other libraries. Oh, this one has only 9 stars. Bassam, I'm not sure what you mean with, because we are not using the database at all in this extension. There is an extension called Friends of Larome Pages. That other extension is using the database, but the extension we are doing today is completely file based, and the files are just on the file system here. And the reason we use the file system is because of a list of reasons I have not listed in the stream, but I have in the post that announces the stream on the forum, I listed a list of benefits. But most of these benefits we will not have time to implement today. But the most important benefit for me is because I will use this on a website where the website source code is on Git. And I want the pages to be on Git as well. And I want people to be able to submit pull requests for pages and be able to merge them and deploy them automatically. So that's why it's file system based. And the other thing is that everything will be cached anyway. So the source will not really be that important. It could be a remote file system. It will not really matter. Yeah, but yeah, speaking of matter, we need that front matter. So we will use this library. So let's just use this one. Okay, let's go to the extension. So now I will install a library inside of my, so it's not really an extension, but it's my package here. So I will run composer require that inside of my package. Okay, and it installed quite quickly. let's check what changed in composer.json. Okay, so we have the YAML front matter. Okay, perfect. So now let's use that function. So YAML front matter parse. The list of pages is not the list of pages is nowhere. I mean, the list of pages is defined by the fact that we check everything that's inside of this folder. There is a folder called pages, and we just loop through every file, and every file that's in here will become a page. That's how it's implemented. YAML front matter parse, and here we actually need to access the file. Oh yeah, we need access to the full file. So get parse. Oh, is it parse or get? Oh, I don't know what. Is it this? Get or get parse name? I never know which method is what. Let's do a var dump just to check that we don't do anything wrong here. So let's go back to the forum, check what happens. So that seems to give me the full path to the file. Because get path, I suppose this one is without the file name, yeah. And get so path. So that's the one I did before, I think. Path name, yeah, and get file name is probably just so it's path, get path name. Okay, so I will use this to access file get contents. Okay. So now, yeah, so I read the file, put it inside of this object called just object. I can actually do this here, and then here I can have title equals array get. Or can I just do it from here, object? I can do this like this, I guess. Okay, so title equals object title, and then we will have the body, which will be put in content. Okay, so now let's check what happens here. Class is not found. Great. The reason we have class not found is because I have installed a new dependency inside of my package, but Flarom itself is not aware that the package changed. So to fix that, we actually need to remove the extension. I think we can also update it, but I find it safer to just remove my package and then add it again in Flarom. And now you can see that Flarom is installing front matter as well. Now I can see that my title is here now. How are we going to display that here? We need a request, so we will need to implement that inside of here. So how am I going to do it? So I need to store the page, so the page will be so we need a model, because the stuff will be in the model. So let's create a folder for models on the JavaScript side. Then let's create a page model. Export default class page extends model. Import from Flarom model. So again, the pages do not come from the database, but we can perfectly use the Flarom store for that, because there is no requirement that the stuff in the Flarom store has to be from the database. So just any mod, you can create a model, and yeah, so this will just be a model for my pages, and here we will have the title, which comes from title, and content that comes from here. Okay, next, what I will actually do is pass something, but I'm not sure if I can pass. I need to access the ID of the page. Oh, but I don't have the ID there. For now, the ID is the path, but in the future, I don't want the ID to be the path. So I need a way to know the page ID. And that's a bit of a problem because how am I going to do this? Because here I have access to vnode, and if I do console.log vnode.attributes, there are some things that are put in the page attributes. Oh no, there is a root name, so that's good. So the root name can be the ID. So generated root, so the ID, so the path name will be that. Okay, next I want to strip the prefix. So how can I do this? I can do is substring a thing? Don't know. JavaScript substring. Okay, so can use that. So how am I doing it? So the page ID will be the root name, and it will be the root name without the start. So the start is my prefix, which is one. I can actually just do it like this. 16 chars long. So we will start at position 16 and we'll take just that. So now we have access to the ID. Let's check if it works. Add a little comment so that we know that 16 is the value from over there. So let's see if it works. So, okay, so I have my ID. For now, it's still just a URL as well, but that's fine. Next, I need to get the page. So the page will be an instance of page. Oh no, everything is called page. let's call this one page model then. I always end up with everything called the same. So let's call the model page model. And this will be page model or null, and it will start with a null value. Okay, next here we need to load the page. I will actually copy paste something. I don't know if I have it ready to copy somewhere. It might be available on Flamarkt. If I manage to type correctly. Don't know if I used this in pages. Oh, because it's here, yeah. Okay, no, so that's the code I want. So I will explain what it does, but yeah, I just need to copy some code. So we need page factory. Yeah, I think I will manage to avoid having something called a factory here. I mean, the thing called repository, you might call it something different. It could almost have been called factory. But yeah, anyway, so I can remove this. Okay, so let me just finish this. So the code I have copy pasted is actually it's actually similar to what Flarom uses on the on a discussion page or on the user profile page. So I will explain what it does. So first this is what we've wrote just previously. We get the ID of the page we want, but then we will need some stuff here. So basically the ID is that we will check if something has been preloaded, because that's a mechanic that we will use later to load the page without an additional API request. So if the page has been preloaded, we will automatically call the show method with the page. Otherwise, we will try to find the page. And to find the page, we need to make a request. Now, this will not really work because the way we did it, the ID of a page will not be used exactly the way the find method expects it. So we will build the URL ourselves. So we will do app.request. We will do a get to app.forum.attribute.api.url, and here we will do / generated root, and then we will have params, and the path will be I will need to use the ID there, I think. Right. For now, it's still exactly the same, so this will work. But basically, yeah, so this is the endpoint we made earlier, so we need to pass a parameter called pass. So we will do it like this. And then here we will do a then. Here we will have a response. And then we will do this dot show. And we will do app.store.pushPayload, and we will use this. So the response will be a JSON object. We will use app.store.pushPayload. This will transform the JSON response into a model, into a JavaScript model, and it will also put it inside of the store. And then we can load it. We can call this.show, and the result, what is returned by that function, will be, in our case, a single page, because the API will return a single page. Okay, and we don't need everything, we just need a read row, because since this will happen asynchronously, so we need to read row the page to tell Mitchell that something changed. And then inside of show, that's where the magic will go. So actually the set title will be moved to here. And here we will set the title to page.title. And now here we will also do something else. So at some point, oh yeah, there is something else missing. So you see, I made a page variable. So actually we will save the page. So we will do this dot page equals page. And we can react to this to know if the page is loaded. So if this dot page is null, then we will return the loading indicator from Flarom. And otherwise, we will return the page. And here we can actually do this.page.title and this.page.content. And let's see what it does. And hello, Tommy. The statistics on YouTube do not tell me if anyone is joining or leaving. I just see that we have almost constantly the same number of people watching, but actually I know that there are rarely people who are online for the full 2 hours. So I guess it's not the same two people all of the time. Let's try what happens here. So there is a change, there is an error. Push payload, the letter E is null. So yeah, that doesn't help us very much. So that kind of error message, it's a mess because good luck finding what is happening. But actually it's not that bad. We have other means. So let's see what happens if we go to the network tab. And you can see that there is a request. We can see if the request works. So the request seems to work. We have some stuff being written. Actually, I know what the error is. Oh yes, it's up to 3 people. It was still saying 2 people just a second ago. Yeah, it's not quick to update on the YouTube side. Yeah, but I know what the error is. I think we will. I hope we can improve that in Flarom at some point. I know what the problem is because I had it before. It's that the model is not recognized by Flarom. Because Flarom actually looks at, if I go back here to the response, Flarom looks at the response here. It sees that the type is generator-page. But then it says, hey, I don't know that. But instead of having a proper error, it just falls to E is null because it tries to get the model. So what we actually need to do is just tell Flarom that that exists. So app.store.models, and here we need to tell Flarom that generator-page is the page model. And I need to import page model from models page. Now Flarom will be able to tell that this is a thing. And it works. It works. Let's try to access another page. So I think I put contact. Yeah, contact is now in a subfolder. So let's see if that works. About/contact. Yeah, that seems to work. Okay, yeah. We are slowly getting running out of time here. I will do one more thing and then I will have to end the stream. The one more thing I will do is actually have the content be valid, because you can see that the title is working. It's in the page title, it's here, but the content is not parsed. So right now you can see here it's supposed to be markdown, but we see the raw markdown. And if I go, there is also the find us page, And you can see this one does not work either, even though it's just HTML. And the reason it does not render is because if we go back to my source code, you can see that the content is just the raw body of the file. And in Flarom, all we do is just put everything inside a paragraph as text. So what we will do? Actually, content, I will change content to be an array. So we will do it like this. Content will become an array. And then here we will no longer put content inside of a paragraph. We will do a map. We will map everything. And here, the first step will be we trust everything as HTML. So we will actually use the m.trust function and we'll return the HTML. And yeah, I see the question in the chat. How do we process Markdown? That's the thing we will do. That's the last thing we will do. Right now, we will just consider that everything is HTML. That way, at least this page will work. So yes, so you can see that now the content is trusted as HTML. Of course, it means that if there is JavaScript or anything in the source code of the page, everything will be put on the page. So so you have to trust the HTML, but that's the reason it's done like that. It's because, yeah, we want the ability to use unrestricted HTML in the page. Yeah, the problem we have, if I go back to terms of use, is that now the Markdown stuff is broken. I mean, it's used as HTML, and in this case, nothing bad happened, apparently. But yeah, it's trusted as HTML, which is not good. So we need a way to parse the Markdown to HTML, and that's the idea. I want the front end will not be aware of the source code format. For the front end, everything will be HTML. So we just need to do something in the back end here. If I find the repository. So here we will do something different. If the page is Markdown. So how are we going to know if it's Markdown? We could try to detect the content, but actually we will just use the file extension. So how can I do? I will do it here. So if the file get extension, if the file extension is MD, then we will do something differently. And how are we going to parse Markdown? Well, again, we can look for libraries that allow us to parse Markdown into HTML, and I know there are plenty, but actually we don't even need a library. We can just use Flarom itself as the parser, because Flarom is able to parse HTML. So actually it's a bit more complicated than other libraries, but basically, yeah, we will parse the content like if it was a Flarom post, and then we will render that post as HTML immediately. So yeah, so basically how it works. So I need to create an instance of the parser, and the parser is available in so I can use text formatter directly. No, actually it's in everything is in a class called formatter. It's this one. Okay, so formatter is a class in Flarom. So I will just type hint it formatter like this. So I resolve the formatter from Flarom, and then the formatter, what can we do with it? We have some functions. One is parse, and another is render, and another is unparse. So basically, parse will take some content and create an XML representation of the content. And usually that's what you will save in your database. And then there is a second step, which is formatter render, which takes the HTML and renders it as HTML. And yeah, that's how we will do it. I hope this will not break. For now, so I used an array here. It's not really necessary for now, but the idea is that in the future, I want to be able to have multiple blocks. We will not have time to do it today, but I'm already doing it like this. So let's see if it works. And oh, what did you say? Did I get a dislike? Yeah, it might be the first dislike. YouTube does not tell me if I get a dislike in the live dashboard. It just tells me how many likes I have. I'll check that later. Yeah, maybe the haters are coming. So it seems like the markdown was parsed. Now we can go back to the about page, which has a link, to see if that worked. That didn't work, but that might be just because Flarom does not have the mail to enabled by default. So maybe we will just put another link just for the demo. So just for those that have not seen the beginning of the stream, what's inside of these files? It's just a markdown file with a front matter, and the title is inside of the front matter. And here, if I just want to put something else, let's just put a link to example.com just to see if that renders correctly. Yeah, and that seems to render correctly. So yeah, that's it. Unfortunately, we did not have time to do this. I wanted to make a custom component and put it inside of the page. Yeah, it will have to be done another time. Maybe we will continue this extension next week. I have not decided what I do next week. I still need to finish this extension. Yeah, the only question is, will I need this extension earlier than next weekend? Because I might need it for one of my websites very soon. So if I need it, I might finish it earlier. Otherwise, I will continue it during the next live stream. Maybe we can just take a look at the list I made on the forum. Can I show this without having anything? I try not to show the forum because there is a risk that you see things that are not supposed to be public. So I'm just in private browsing, just in the discussion. Just here we had the list of what I want to be able to do with this extension, just so you know the ideas. So one of the things that was listed previously was the ability to have version control. So that's already handled by the fact that it's static files. Next, there was another benefit, which was pretty URLs without prefixes. So that's a benefit over the Friends of Flarom extension, because here you can really have any path. And if I go back here, yeah, you can see the URLs are clean. There is no prefix. There is no limitation on the syntax for the pages. And yeah, you can have sub pages, at least visually. Yeah, so that's the idea. If I go back, so other things was nested paths, so that's what I just said. Translatable, so that we didn't have time to do. But that's an important path, that important thing that I will do in the next time we work on it. I want to be able to have, yeah, a different... Actually, the idea is that right now I have a folder just called pages, but I want to be able to create a different folder, which might be pages-fr or something for another language, or I might have a folder called en and a folder called fr and etc. And yeah, and then in the extender here, when I add a source, I want to be able to say the language, and then this will be used to change the language, change the source depending on the current language in FlaRoma. So that's something else I want to do. Ability to include mutual components. So we didn't have time to do that, but that's high on the list of things I want to do, because I will have some websites where I will need to include some stuff in between, and yeah, it's best if it can be mutual components. That's why I don't need to have some DOM manipulation or something else. So yeah. Oh, I see the question. Yeah, I will get back to the markdown just to explain. Yes. We just finished this list. Then there was a different path for different language, so that's linked to the translation ability. Page access control, that's actually something I want to also add. I want that in the, I want to allow you to, in the front matter, so I want the ability in the front matter to list, here you can for example say allow groups and list some groups, and only these groups will be able to see the page. So that's something I want to implement as well. Then we have class names and templates, so that's something we also didn't do. Right now all the pages have the same base template around them, but I want to give you not really multiple templates, but the ability to have class names or something so that you can customize groups of pages. And I also want the ability to keep the link, because right now the sidebar, I mean, keep the sidebar that's here. I want that to be a flag so you can choose if you want it on your custom page or not. And if I go back to the list, some ability to have open graph meta on the page, because that will be useful for social context. Yeah. So yeah, we might do that next week. Yeah. And Bassam was asking, how did I parse the markdown? So it's those three steps here. So text formatter has multiple steps. So I will just dump everything so you can see. So I will do var dump. No, maybe I just do echo. So you can see, so the first step is getting the raw body. So if I just dump that, I get the body from the front matter library that just separates the front matter from the rest. So if I just show you what happens, so the first step is just getting the body. So you can see here, that's the raw markdown. Then the next step is to call formatter parse. So formatter is that class from FlaRoM that I resolved from the container. And then when I call formatter parse and pass the body, the raw markdown as a parameter. Actually we don't see because I need to go to the page source code. So maybe if I just go back one step. So the first step is the raw markdown. So the raw markdown is just like this. So it's just text. And here we have the little form thing that does nothing. Then we call formatter parse, and that will transform the source into an XML file. And you don't really need to know how it works, but you can see there are some tags. There is a tag called R, there is a tag called P, there is a tag called URL, there is a tag called S. Basically, that's how the text formatter in FlaRoM is able to store the post inside of the database. And the beauty of that format is that it's a midway between the source and the output. So basically, it's it's already partially parsed, but based on that, you can still go back to the source code. It's useful when you edit a post. In our case, it's not useful because we don't need a page editor based on that. But yeah, so that format is what Flarom is using in the database. And yeah, you don't really need to understand how it works. It just allows storing some additional information that might not be visible on the post, and it's also best for performance. And then there is another step, which is to take that XML. And when you take that XML and give it to the render method, then it will give you HTML. And basically, in our situation, it just removes some of the stuff from the markdown, from the XML, and you get that. And yeah, I'm not sure you ask why we don't use a library. You mean for parsing? This is a library. This is text formatter, which is not from Flarom. So text formatter is a library made to handle content, but just not just markdown. Actually, the beauty of this solution is that you can use anything that's available in Flarom. So if I go back to my page, what page was that? It was the contact page. Oh, I'm no longer on the page. If I go back to the page, the beauty of this is that if I edit my page, I can actually use anything. I can also use BB code. For example, if I use the B tag, I can use BB code. I can use anything that an extension from Flarom has registered. So even if I have, do I still have the extension? I have this one. I like to use that example. Like, for example, if you have the Comic CMS extension, well, you can just use Comic on your page now because it's using the Flarom text formatter. So anything that was registered in Flarom automatically becomes available here. That's the beauty of using the text formatter inside of your extension. Even if it's not for posts, it's that extensions can register new things. So yeah, for example, if you wanted Comic CMS with the nice rainbow, you can use that feature. So yeah, maybe the file extension should not be markdown. It should be maybe a text formatter or something like that, so that you know that it will also parse stuff that's not markdown. But yeah, basically that's the idea. Yeah, was there other things? Yeah, this extension is going to become a must. I hope so, but I guess many people will not really like the way that you have to create pages. I guess it depends how familiar people are with Markdown and just manipulating stuff on the server. Because yeah, you will need to manually create some files. But it will have a lot of uses, I'm sure. So yeah, I have two websites that will need this. The first website that need it is just for the terms of use. I need a page for the terms of use and a page for contact. So that's the first website that will use it. That website is in a single language, so it's very simple. So I will test it there first. But then later I will have another website that I will show you in the streams, but I'm still not quite there yet. But yeah, I have a very complex website in 4 different languages that needs to have pages that people can contribute to via GitHub. So that's where the biggest things are useful with this extension. Yes, the problem with access control and homepage is that this extension will not solve that problem because right now I'm not planning to have multiple pages have the same URL. Because if you want multiple pages to be homepage but not be visible to the same person, that's a problem, because you need two different pages that change this. Yeah, you need some custom logic in the middle, because if you register the two pages first and then check the access control, but you cannot register two pages with the same URL. So you need the access control above the URL registration, and then that's also something that this extension will not natively support, but this might be added in a later version. But yeah, the best, if you have a homepage that has different content for different people, would be to just use the Flahome API directly and register a page that changes. If the content is not confidential, you can just use class names and a bit of JavaScript to change what is shown. Or it could also be a feature in Flahome to change which homepage it is, and But then the access control is at the Flahome level and not at the page level. Yeah, anyway, there are solutions, but indeed, I have seen the comments on the forum about that. It's not possible without writing custom code at the moment. And this extension I'm doing is not going to immediately solve the problem either, but it might help a bit. Yeah, so I will stop there. Let me switch back to full screen. Yes, is there still some lag? No, it's not too bad today. Sometimes the webcam starts to lag behind. I don't know why. So thanks for everyone who joined. We still have 3 people watching. I'll check out what the hater thing is. Actually, I can just check. How can I go to the video page from the YouTube studio? You cannot really go to the page. Let me just check that. How many haters do we have? Don't know if I get many dislikes. Okay, there is a dislike. Yeah. I'll check back. I don't know if I have dislikes on other videos. This might be a new achievement. Yeah. Okay, so thanks for watching. I will try to do next stream next Sunday. We might continue this extension. Maybe I will do a bit of work in the meantime. Yeah. And yeah, if you would like to support this channel directly, you can support on the Patreon or via GitHub sponsors, but you don't need to give money to me. If you want to donate to the Flahome Foundation directly, I much prefer you do that, because yeah, it helps Flahome. I don't directly need support for this channel. That's not directly managed by Flahome. That's just something on the side that I do. So yeah, thanks for joining, and I will see you next week. Bye.